What's up, YouTubers? So before we get started with this video, on First Take, they're going to be talking about how Blake Griffin signed with the Brooklyn Nets. So let's see what they have to say about that.
And the Nets are keeping it very interesting this season, now adding six-time All-Star forward Blake Griffin to the squad. According to Adrian Wojnarowski, Brooklyn used one of its veteran minimum contracts slots to sign Griffin, who will likely be used as a small ball center off the bench. Not only is he joining the Big Three on a quest for a title, but also former Clippers teammate DeAndre Jordan. So, Max.
Man, everybody's signing with the Brooklyn Nets. I think Blake Griffin might put them over the top. And they only signed him for what, their veteran minimum. So if he doesn't pan out, they're not going to be losing much.
What do you think? Will Griffin have a little, big, or no impact? There you go, on the team this year.
I'll say a small impact. And I'll say so giving him the benefit of the doubt, thinking that he'll be very motivated to be the best version of himself on this Brooklyn team. But I take no pleasure in saying this. I remember when Blake broke into the league, and I was out in L.A. doing afternoon drive on ESPN radio, and it's a Lakers station, but you couldn't ignore what was happening with the Clippers. Blake Griffin looked like he had a chance to be one of the greatest power forwards who ever lived. He was he was something different athletically, but it didn't quite pan out that way. He was an all-star, not an MVP. It didn't quite pan out that way, and after he got injured, he hasn't been the same. Guys, you know the last time Blake Griffin dunked? Jalen Rose pointed this out a month ago or something like
that. Yeah, and dunked in 2 years.
2 years? It's been 2 years since he dunked the basketball. So you take that away.
Wait a minute, so it's been 2 years since Blake Griffin dunked? You got to be kidding me. Well, I guarantee you his first game with the Brooklyn Nets, he might do a self-pass 360 windmill dunk two or three times just to show how happy he is to be with a team that has a great chance of getting to the championship, if not winning a championship.
From Blake, and what do you have? He's not really a defender, and he's just not built like a defender. No, defenders aren't the barrel-chested guys. They're like the lanky, long-armed dudes who can play defense, usually, right? He's not built like a defender, and he's not a defender, really. Not a shot blocker, not a rim protector. He's not a shooter. He takes six threes a game. He hits under 32% of them. So what is it exactly that Blake now does that's additive, right? How does he positively affect the team? I'm willing to believe, given the amount of time he hung around as an all-star and given his basketball savvy at this point in his career, that a fully motivated Blake Griffin as a center maybe in a small ball lineup, that idea has been floated, will have some marginal positive value. But Stephen A., I think that's what it is. He's Blake in name only at this point.
I think you're sleeping.
I think that might be enough. I think Blake Griffin could definitely contribute to those guys. I mean, they already have a championship team. And then you add Blake, even if he just contributes a little bit, that'll be enough to definitely get them over the hump. Especially barring if Anthony Davis isn't able to come back and be what he was before his injury. Those boys are going to be on fire.
Sleeping on what he can bring to the table, but it's understandable. As you know, listen, from time to time, I do have to teach you the game of basketball. I understand the stuff, Max. So let me school you about something here, Max.
Stephen Naismith.
That's Stephen Naismith. There you go. Here's the deal. Seriously. Blake Griffin is not a number one option. He's not a number two option. Here's the beauty. He doesn't even have to be a number four option or Brooklyn. You're forgetting that. The people that you play with, what you're surrounded by, has a profound impact on how you can perform when you're not asked to do but so much any longer. When I think about Blake Griffin's, athleticism since his injuries, it's dissipated to some degree. There's no question about it. But I think primarily the issue in Detroit, was the fact that he didn't want to be there. He knew that it was a team going nowhere. He knew they were in rebuilding mode. He never wanted to leave. He never wanted to depart L.A., which is why he ran off instead of shaking hands with Steve Ballmer when he came back for a visit. He never wanted to leave. He liked being in another L.A. or Detroit, where you want to be. I know where I want to be. So we understand.
Nothing against Detroit. Love
Nothing
me some
Detroit.
Detroit.
We love the city, but come on now. Let's just be real with it. And so I'm just talking strictly weather. And so as a result of that, you look at it from that perspective, he wasn't that interested. Max, the guy has played in 38 games in like 19 of the last 20 months or so. 38 games.
Yeah.
He hasn't been playing. All right, the last time we saw him in a full season, he was averaging 24 and a half points a game. When I think about that, and I think about him reuniting, rather, with DeAndre Jordan. and I think about James Harden and Kyrie, and then you add KD to the mix. Excuse me, you got to worry about those three. I'm sorry, Blake Griffin is no scrub. He's not somebody that you can sit up there and leave alone, and he's not somebody that you can easily guard one-on-one. And because you'll have to prioritize focusing on the other three when it really, really counts, that's from a basketball perspective. Then you've got the motivational element that we can't ignore. Then you got the fact that he's reunited with his teammate in DeAndre Jordan. All of those things coming together, and Brooklyn desperately needed a bigger another big body, because all you really had was DeAndre Jordan and obviously shipping Jared Allen off to Cleveland. So you got
Jeff Green, ain't it?
Jeff Green.
No, but I'm saying not as a big body.
Not as a big body, but Jeff Green can ball. But again, Blake Griffin enables you to go small. Let me ask you this question. If you had James Harden, Kyrie Irving, KD on the court with Jeff Green and Blake Griffin to go small, that's nothing to sneeze at.
Or Joe Harris.
That's nothing to sneeze at all. That's like an all-star lineup right there.
That's right. Or Joe Harris. You see what I'm saying? So, in other words, Blake Griffin can work with this group.
Yeah.
If he were going someplace else where he was asked to be a number one or two option, I would have a problem with it. I would side with you. But him being in Brooklyn, I think it's one of the perfect landing spots. I think he helps elevate them, and I think he elevates them significantly because he gives you an extra body that can do some things, not on a night-in, night-out basis, but I'm talking about sporadically. Can Blake Griffin go out there and give you 20 or 30? Yes, he can.
I'm saying, yes.
Yeah, Blake Griffin's going to come back highly motivated. Like I said, in his first game with the Brooklyn Nets, that guy just might do it. Like I said, a self-pass 360 windmill jam two or three times just to show how happy he is to be there with Brooklyn, the Brooklyn Nets, and just start taking care of business. We're going to see a whole new side of Blake Griffin. Especially, he hasn't dunked in the past 2 years. That's ridiculous.
But that's a small difference. Like,
it's not a small difference when you consider their roster.
Joe Harris is, whether he's starting or where, however you're going to do it, in crunch time, Joe Harris should be on the floor. He's the best shooter on the team, amazingly, right? In fact, in our morning meeting, when we were talking about, like, you know, do they have a big four, I was stumped. I was like, wait, are people considering Joe Harris part of a big four? Because that's how I've viewed Blake Griffin the last couple of years. I think of Sean Kemp. I think of Larry Johnson. These were, like Blake Griffin, they were once a certain kind of player, and they were all-stars. And they had to reinvent themselves as their careers went on due to injury, age, size, whatever.
Primarily when Larry Johnson is back.
Right. And they did a very – Larry Johnson was one of the highest IQ players I've ever seen on the
Knicks. Absolutely.
But he couldn't jump anymore. He wasn't as good as he was, but he reinvented himself.
But he was still formidable.
Sean Kemp, too, got down in the post, wasn't like, high-flying anymore. It's, you know.
But his game was predicated on that. That was never the case with Larry Johnson.
But –
Yeah, Sean Kemp was a beast.
Larry Johnson wasn't a skywalker when he was at UNLV.
But he could jump. He could jump after the back.
He was massive. Right, he was a man among boys. But he wasn't a jumper.
Without getting bogged down in the Larry Johnson
Stacey Ogden
stuff,
Anderson Hunt were the jumpers, not him. But go
what
ahead.
I'm saying is, there are guys who reinvented themselves. I don't know that Blake can do that on a level to make him...
Nah, he can't.
Big deal.
I think he has to.
But